Well, you heard heart to heart. We'll talk maybe a bit about that in a moment, but maybe they should learn a little bit more about us.
Just in a nutshell, since this is a Valentine's banquet, we'll start with who we are, our love story. We have been married almost, this July will be 33 years. Yes. Yeah. I was 8.
I don't think so.
Just so we're clear on that.
We actually met at university, as you heard. We were actually, it's a Christian liberal arts university, yeah. And we were in psychology class together. Yeah. So you have a lot of mostly Bible courses, but we had a psychology class. Mm-hmm. And so it was like a class of 90 people, and I saw Anne on the other side of the classroom.
It was like kind of like a semicircle class where the professor was here and all the students' chairs were kind of around him. So Ron was over here and I was over there. So it's amazing how you can angle your chair just so that you can see him right through and then look around like you really don't notice
and
that he's there.
I would look at her until she noticed me noticing her, and then I would look away. Of course, you know how that starts out that way.
None of you have ever
and,
done that,
in
I'm
psychology
sure.
class, I guess we were trying to psychoanalyze each other across the room.
Anyway, almost 33 years later, we have 3 kids. Well, they're not kids anymore. They're grown, but they'll still always be my babies. A daughter and 2 sons. Our daughter is 30, and she has given us our 2 grandbabies. Mm-hmm. Woo-hoo! Yay! Jadis is 4, and Declan is 6 months old. And so Andrea is 30, Adam, we have an Adam. Our Adam is 27, and Eric, our baby, is 24. Now, our baby is the biggest. He is 6 feet 8 inches tall. He's a big boy.
Big boy, yeah.
He's a youth pastor, actually, at a church in Brantford, and his wife is the children's pastor at the same church. So it works out well for them.
And we know there's a great need for marriage ministry today, and many are looking for relationships and help wherever they can find it. In fact, one woman, she wrote in to an online technical support place for marriage help. And so this is how it went.
This is what she wrote. Dear technical support, last year I upgraded from boyfriend 5.0 to husband 1.0 and noticed a distinct slowdown in overall system performance, particularly in the flower and jewelry applications, which operated flawlessly under boyfriend 5.0. In addition, husband 1.0 uninstalled many other valuable programs such as Romance 9.5 and Personal Attention 6.5, and then installed undesirable programs such as NBA 5.0, NFL 3.0, and Golf 4.1. Conversation 8.0 no longer runs, and House Cleaning 2.6 simply crashes the system. Please note that I have tried running Nagging 5.3 to fix these problems, but to no avail. What can I do? Signed, Desperate.
And surprisingly, a response came a few weeks later, out of the blue, and this is what came back from technical support. Dear Desperate, first keep in mind, Boyfriend 5.0 is an entertainment package, while Husband 1.0 is an operating system. Please enter command, I thought you loved me.html, and try to download Tears 6.2. Do not forget to install the Guilt 3.0 update. If that application works as designed, Husband 1.0 should then automatically run the applications Jewelry 2.0 and Flowers 2.5. However, remember, overuse of the above application can cause Husband 1.0 to default to Grumpy Silence 2.5. Whatever you do, do not, under any circumstances, install Mother-in-Law 1.0.
Don't do that.
Because it runs a virus in the background that will eventually seize control of all your system resources. In addition, please do not attempt to reinstall the Boyfriend 5.0 program. These are unsupported applications now and will crash Husband 1.0. So in summary, Husband 1.0 is a great program, but it does have limited memory. and cannot learn new applications quickly. You might consider buying additional software to improve overall performance. We recommend cutting some slack 3.0, a back rub 4.0, and a date night 5.0. It says good luck. And so this is a date night for a lot of you here.
So you're in the right place. We're going to have some fun tonight with you. But also, if you don't mind, we might slip in a few little teaching moments. That's what we do these days. We conduct marriage seminars. We travel all over and spend complete full days with couples in churches or in events. And we have a lot of fun just unpacking what it is to be happily married God's way. And we know that what the world gives us is not exactly God's way. And so we have a lot of fun with that. So tonight we're going to have fun with you, but we're also going to give you some nuggets as well.
And we realize not everyone here is a married couple. I think there's some dating couples.
How many are married? Married couples, raise your hand. Oh, okay.
That's
yeah.
The vast majority.
We're in the majority. All right. You guys, you're not married, just listen in.
Yeah. There we go. Our vision statement at Heart to Heart is to see every marriage become a loving union that creates a safe family haven, building a legacy of hope for future generations. We're looking into the future here when we get married and we see all the potential God has for us and through us into the future. I'm sure heard a lot of statistics, and this Canadian stat says in Canada, 41% of marriages will end in divorce before their 30th anniversary. And that's certainly sad to hear. Mm-hmm. But some good news is that there's only a 9% divorce rate when a couple both come from a stable home. And that just goes to show how important it is to have those stable homes, to establish your home as with that stability, with God at the center. And it makes a huge difference to the next generation.
So that really is an encouragement for all of us to keep working on our marriages. Don't give up, because you know what? Our children are watching, and our grandchildren are watching. And if they see us working on our marriages and improving and getting better as our marriage ages, then they're going to have a good example to follow afterwards as well.
And the best news is every marriage has a 100% chance of success when it's done God's way. Marriage as God intended. Do you believe that?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, so we all know that men and women are different in a lot of ways. In fact, girls, we could probably write a book on things that men just do not understand. Am I right? Okay, things like, can we get real here? Menstrual cramps. I'm sorry, I went there, I said it, but it's true. They will never understand what that is all about. Labor pains, delivering a baby, they just don't get it. I'm sorry. So the Lord and I have worked out a deal, okay? And it's a true story. For Ron's first week in heaven, I get him. He's all mine. And for that first week in heaven, he is going to experience all of these things, okay? He's going to have PMS. Okay, you know what PMS is? PMS is when you're angry and you're ticked off and you have no idea why, but you just are. That's PMS. Like, I don't understand it, but I experience it. My new favorite, hot flashes. Anybody else experience hot flashes? Okay, now you'd be aging yourself, and we don't want to do that. But trust me, it's not something you want to experience. But Ron will experience hot flashes. And what about Spanx? Okay, all day wearing Spanx, it's like this tight sock that you're pulling up on your body, and it's not comfortable.
But I have one word, wrong.
But Ron's,
wrong.
Ron, you're trying to be Donald Trump.
did you see the debates? I'll just say wrong.
Ron's first week in heaven, he is going to experience all of that.
No, I don't. I think I'm going to think I've gone to the other place if that happens, right? I don't want that kind of week in heaven. So anyway, I don't like that deal she has.
No, it's true. It's going to happen.
Okay, well, as we said, men and women are very different. We don't have to say that many times. Everyone knows that. And sometimes it's not until we're in an unusual situation, a very unusual situation, mm-hmm. that these differences come out. Mm-hmm. And we had one of those situations very early in marriage. In fact, it was on our wedding day.
It was on our wedding day. Sometime during our wedding ceremony, we lost two of our groomsmen. Now, it's not that we didn't know where they were. We knew exactly where they were. They were on the platform, on the carpet, out cold. Two of our groomsmen fainted during our wedding. No joke. And so this was before America's Funniest Home Videos. We could have made
but
some
money. But we did have a video camera kind of up in the corner of the church, and it was just kind of would zoom in and out. And so would you like to see a little clip?
What do you think?
Okay.
So
let's set it up with the walk down the aisle.
Okay, this is just, go ahead and press that. This is just the beginning of our wedding, July 7th, 1984. I was young, innocent, 20-year-old bride.
I thought you said you were eight.
Innocent, 8-year-old okay. bride, just walking down the aisle to my Prince Charming. We had rehearsed. I had seven bridesmaids, seven groomsmen, three flower girls, and a partridge and a pear tree. I mean, it was going to work out just right. We had it all planned out.
We went through the vows, and then we went to have communion and just kind of knelt at the communion bench. And my father started having the communion with us, and my Uncle Glenn started singing the Lord's Prayer.
It was beautiful. But
so
if
we'll
you
start
watch...
this.
The video, and you see the gentleman as the camera zooms out at the bottom of your screen. See the back of his head there? Well, as the song begins, something happens to poor Doug.
He starts to get a little bit woozy, and just watch him there for a second, and he's wobbling, and timber! Down he goes.
There he goes.
Now, and so it caused a little bit of a commotion. People went over to kind of help him out and just...
So Doug was 6'5" tall, okay, 6'5". So when he hit the platform, there was a thud. And I looked over, and you can't really see it there, and the first thing I thought was, how did his glasses land on his chest? I don't know why I thought that, but honestly, that was my first thought. And then I thought, oh, he fainted. But then, you know what, people were coming to help him, and I thought, okay, well, it'll be okay. We're just gonna, Uncle Glenn will keep singing, and everything will be fine. We're kneeling down for communion.
And then, if you go back to that clip, at the top, you see there's a couple there, and his name is Kelly. Right
to the left of the candles. See the couple
to the left of the candles up at the top of the picture.
Yeah.
He's gonna be the next one to go down, but. But you won't actually see him because it'll be zoomed in to us, but you'll see
our reaction. Okay, so it's very quick off the top. You'll see. We're going to start to look to the left. Ready? And
then all of a sudden, boom, he fell down.
Okay, so Kelly's down.
He actually got his head wedged between the piano, the grand piano, and the upper platform.
And his eyes were rolled back in his head, and
so we're looking over at that.
Now, at this point, everyone... I'm thinking, what is going on? They're going to stop my wedding. Lord, and so you can see my lips are moving. The tears are flowing. I'm praying. I'm having it out with the Lord right now. I'm saying, Lord, what's going on? Please don't let them stop the wedding. Please don't let this stop. They're dropping like flies. Lord, please don't let them stop my wedding. Like, what's going on? Lord, please. And so I'm just praying and praying and praying. Meanwhile, look at Mr. Spirituality next to me. He's singing his praise, you Lord. Not a care in the world. Look at me. I'm still shaking my head. Lord, what is going on? They're going to stop the wedding. And he's got his eyes closed, just lost in worship.
That song wasn't planned, but Uncle Ralph, he just kind of started that out of the blue just to kind of take time... make up some time while they're tending to this guy. Mm-hmm. Anyway, the clip shows the difference between Anne and me. I'm more of the laid back, nothing ruffles my feathers, steady Eddie kind of guy.
Rock of Gibraltar, steady.
But Anne, not so much.
Not so much. I wear my heart on my sleeve, and I'm right there. But so it could be in your marriage that it's the opposite. Maybe the husband is more emotional and the wife is more of the steady Eddie. But it doesn't matter. The main thing is that quite often we marry the opposite. We marry someone who's not like us. And the beautiful thing is we have the opportunity through marriage to enlarge these differences and celebrate these differences and really make it a good thing, not a bad thing.
So we want to look at the differences between men and women and his needs and her needs in marriage, but in a moment. But first of all, it's important that we understand that there are some of the deepest needs that we all have that only God can meet. All right, these deepest needs, the same for every person on the planet, married or single, male or female. We all have these deepest needs in our lives that only God can meet those. And so we want to look at these very quickly. First of all, acceptance answers that big question everyone has. Am I loved? Am I accepted? The answer is yes. God loves you with an everlasting love. He loves you just the way that you are. Christ died to save us, to redeem us, and that's such good news. We are accepted, and so we can know that. Only God can meet that real deep acceptance need.
That's right. The next of the four deepest needs that only God can meet is identity. Who am I? Am I a wife? Am I a mother? Am I a grandmother? Am I a daughter? Am I a teacher? Am I a nurse? Who am I? Who am I? And God wants you to know that you are a cherished child of His, for whom He paid the ultimate price to show His love. Your identity is rooted in Jesus, and that's something that we need to understand before we ever walk down the aisle to anyone else, that our identity is first and foremost rooted in Him.
Number three of our deepest needs is security, answering the question, am I safe? And we all need to know that. And this is the security, though, in the ultimate sense. As His child, we are safe in His everlasting arms. Amen? And that's for now and for eternity. And that's so wonderful to know that we have that sense of security in Him, one of our deepest needs.
That's right. And the fourth of the deepest needs that only God can meet is purpose. Why am I here? Am I here to do more, to be more, to make more? No. You have been created with a unique purpose that God has designed uniquely for you because He has created you as an individual. And it's an eternal purpose. And as you get to know Him, He will reveal to you what that purpose is. And you will have that deepest need fulfilled.
And whether you realize it or not, these four deepest needs have been driving you in your decisions and in your life. Throughout your life. And when these needs go unmet, there's an emptiness and a pain that many try to fill with different things, even try to medicate with things like drugs and alcohol and food and work even, and various relationships trying to fill these deepest needs. But none of them can fill what's missing in our life and satisfy those. Only God can. So we wanted to kind of start with that. There are needs, yes, there's His needs and her needs in marriage, but there are needs only God can meet.
And here's an important point when it comes to thinking about those and marriage. Psychologists talk about something called the principle of transference, and it goes like this. If I don't depend on God to meet those four deepest needs, I automatically transfer my dependence onto my spouse. And that is setting him up for failure because I'm putting unrealistic expectations on him. I am depending on him in an unhealthy way because I've transferred those deepest needs that only God can meet onto my husband, and there's no way he's going to meet all of those needs.
There's a famous line that Tom Cruise does in one of his movies, and he looks deeply into his special woman's eyes and says, "You complete me." I don't know if you remember that one, but then all the women swoon. But the truth is...
It is romantic. I mean, you
worked,
have to admit,
it
is. It
worked good for the movie. But the truth is, we are complete in Him.
Only Him.
In Him. And that's why a single person can live a fully complete life.
That's right.
You don't even have to be married to have that sense of completeness in yourself because God completes us. And He meets those four deepest needs. Mm-hmm. And so that's good news.
Yeah.
Amen. Okay, now let's talk about love for a moment. I think we're talking about love today, right? It's a Valentine's banquet. So, love. In English, we know that word gets tossed around for just about everything. You know, I love lasagna. I love that meal tonight. Mm-hmm. I love our two little dogs.
Charlie and Bella.
I love the Blue Jays.
I thought you were going to say I love our two little grandchildren.
Yes.
He went to the dogs instead of the grandchildren. I don't know.
But love, it gets used for such a variety of things in the English language. But in the Greek language of the New Testament, there are five different words that often get translated in the Bible as love. Epithumia is a strong desire or lust. Eros is a passionate, sensual desire or longing. Storge is like a family affection between parents and children. Philia is more of a friendship or brotherly love. And then there's agape love.
Agape love is the only love not rooted in emotions. It is an act of the will, unconditional, sacrificial, and absolutely committed. It is not dependent on your feelings.
And so it's important to have that distinction. Emotions or feelings are inherent in all these other types of love, but not agape love. This is the God kind of love. Agape love drove Jesus to meet our deepest needs, to be saved from our sin and have a relationship with him, and to give us acceptance, identity, security, and purpose. And that was his agape love that he poured out to us unconditionally. When we operate in this kind of love, in marriage setting, it gives us a desire to reach outside of ourselves and meet our spouse's greatest needs, the kind of needs that we can meet. Agape love seeks the highest good for the other person. And it's been said that the opposite of love is not hate, but it's actually selfishness in that sense. And so it's interesting that agape happens to be the word the Apostle Paul uses in his famous marriage passage in Ephesians chapter 5.
And it goes like this. Husbands, love, agape your wives as Christ loves, agapes the church, and gave himself for her. Let each one of you in particular so love, agape, his own wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband.
So the best way to live out that kind of agape love in marriage is meeting your spouse's greatest needs, and again, distinguished from those deepest needs only God can meet. So what are some of these needs? And we'll talk about that. But agape love is the kind of love you committed to at the altar of the church where you were married. Not based on feelings. You said for better or for worse, for richer or for poorer, in sickness and in health. I heard one woman who say, well, I took him for better or for worse, but he's worse than I took him for. But anyway, I think she needed to exhibit a little agape love there. It means that we go beyond our comfort zones and do the work, make the sacrifice. It's forgetting about ourselves and focusing on the needs of your spouse. So what are his and her needs? And that's what we want to talk about.
So if we were to ask, and this is where we're going to get into a little bit of the nitty-gritty. I hope you don't mind, but I think it's going to help as we move beyond the beginning of love stages and see exactly, if we boil it down, what exactly are our greatest needs as husbands and wives. So if we were to ask each man in this room to really consider what it is that you need or desire most from your wife, to really, really think about it. According to marriage expert Jimmy Evans, your answers would all fall in the same three categories. They may be worded differently, but they would fall into the same three categories. And for women too, and we're going to get to the women's in a minute. But so for the man's greatest needs, we'll put those up, his greatest needs are honor and respect in order of importance, sexual intimacy, and friendship.
Now, guys might think we got the first two flip-flopped, you got those wrong, but no, stay with us here, I know. But no, those are the top three that are pretty common
guys. So first we're going to look at honor and respect. Now, girls, this is his mega need. This need is bigger than all other needs, his mega need. What do we mean by honor him? How do you show honor to your husband? By seeing the best in him, by building him up in front of other people, in front of his friends, in front of your children, in front of your family, your parents, your siblings, your cousins, your grandparents, building him up, genuinely building him up. Make a habit of showing him that you appreciate him in your tone of voice in your actions, in your words. And even if you find it hard to come up with something, maybe it's a little tough right now. You know what? You're saying, Ann, sure, sounds good, but it's kind of hard for me to show him honor right now. Things aren't the greatest. You know what? Find something to build him up with, because it has been proven that a man will rise to the level of honor that he has shown from his wife, and eventually he will become that man deserving of honor. You just give it to him anyway. And this point is crucial, and I want to put it on the screen because it's so important. Honor is oxygen for his soul. He will gravitate to that place where he receives the most oxygen. So when you give your husband honor, you are literally filling him, filling his world with life-giving oxygen and drawing him to you. Now, conversely, if he is not receiving that mega need at home, he will be drawn to wherever he is getting it, if at work, if he's being shown honor from his coworkers or from his friends, he will be drawn there and he will retreat from where he's not receiving it. So we really need to remember this is a mega need, and we need to fill him, fill those places that where he is with life-giving oxygen. So right now, if you're here with your husband, I want you to do something. I want you to take his hand, girls. I want you to look him in the eye. Okay, get ready. And I want you to say to him, I honor the man that you are, and I thank God that you're mine. Go ahead. I honor the man that you are, and I thank God that you're mine. Kind of
right.
Fun to do that, isn't it? You can do that anytime you want.
Okay. Moving on, number two of the men's husband's top three needs is this thing called sexual intimacy. And studies show that 80% of men have a stronger sex drive than their wives. Probably not a big revelation for most of you. So when it comes to sexual appetite, most men and women are completely out of sync. Not only are they not on the same page, that they might not even be reading from the same book, okay? And so this often results in tremendous friction in marriage. And however, when a wife is truly committed to having a fulfilling marriage, meeting this particular need becomes a priority for her. And so that's what all we'll say on that. But we'll let the Bible say a little bit on that. The Apostle Paul is pretty clear about sexual needs within marriage, in the covenant of marriage, when he writes this. The husband should fulfill his wife's sexual needs, and the wife should fulfill her husband's needs. The wife gives authority over her body to her husband, and the husband gives authority over his body to his wife. Pretty strong words, pretty clear. Nowhere in Scripture are we given a more graphic example of what it means to become one flesh. In marriage, we willingly commit to give our spouse complete access to everything that we have, including our bodies. It's the ultimate act of service and humility, and the context of that scripture I just read is meeting this vital need so that we don't give Satan an opening for temptation when this need goes unmet. Some pretty practical stuff, isn't it?
Yeah.
Don't you love the Bible? How many appreciate how straightforward the Bible is on a lot of these topics?
That's right.
Yeah.
And his third need in order is friendship. Friendship is crucial in marriage because it's been said that, let's put this one up, it's not necessarily a lack of love, but a lack of friendship that makes unhappy marriages. Now note that we didn't say these marriages end, just that they're unhappy. Friendship is the refreshment that keeps marriages from going old and stale. Friendship is the glue that kind of helps you stick together when those times are getting tough, and you need to laugh together, you need to bond together, you need to have those moments where just the two of you can be friends and be close friends, be best friends. It's been said that if you have to invite your best friend to your wedding, you might be marrying the wrong person. We should be marrying our best friend, shouldn't we? I mean, it doesn't mean that I can't have a best girlfriend or whatever, you know. But it means that my very best friend, my true soulmate, my true kindred spirit, should be my husband because he knows me the best, knows me better than anybody else, warts and all. He's been there through the ups and downs, through all the years, and he loves me more than anybody does. And that is a place of honor, and that is a place for a best friend.
And it's important for our wives to understand this point here. While women tend to bond through meaningful conversation, men bond through having fun together. Is that right, guys?
It's true.
We go hang out, we go do something fun with your guy friends, and that's kind of how you bond as guys. Women develop friendships like this.
We do not sound like that.
Whereas men develop friendships like this. Or, right? Hey, there you go.
It's true.
So that's important to understand that, for women to understand that you want to do things with your man that maybe you can enjoy together, something that builds that bond.
And don't be afraid to enter into his world. You know what he enjoys doing, and maybe give it a try. It might be something that you find, you surprise yourself. You kind of, you have fun fishing too, or whatever. I know with us, Ron is very, now don't let this mild-mannered, steady Eddie thing fool you. He is very competitive. Extremely competitive. And so you should see him on the basketball court. Oh, yeah. So when we play board games or card games together, most of the time, he wins. But I have so much fun trash-talking him, you know, just kind of needling him. And sometimes I actually win.
What about my honor and respect, huh?
Okay, well, we just kind of ignore that for just a little while. But then we bring it back. There you bring it back. And we really enjoy playing Settlers of Catan. I don't know if anybody else plays. It's a really fun board game. And I do beat him at that game. So anyway.
I heard of one couple that they seemed to be drifting apart, and it wasn't really a lot of closeness there. And this woman heard this teaching about kind of entering a man's world and doing things with him and to help that bonding. And so she said to her husband, "You know what, honey? Next, when you go out hunting again, I'd like to come with you." And that kind of shocked him, and actually kind of worried him because he thought maybe she wants to get him alone with a firearm. But he said, "Okay, well, come on." And they went out. They went out in the bush. They were out hunting, looking, and in that time, well, just kind of waiting for whatever animal coming along. I don't know what they were hunting, but they had their rifles and just looking out. And they started talking and opening up. And she said that had been the first time in a long time that he really opened up like that. She kind of entered into his world and did something on a friendship level and a companionship that was really important. Okay, where are we, hon?
Moving on.
Okay, let's go to her needs. How about that? We didn't forget you, ladies. Okay.
All right.
Okay, her top three needs.
Her top three needs are security, soft, non-sexual affection, and open and honest communication. And this is in order of importance.
Okay, security. Now, this is a different kind of security than the ultimate security that we talked about that only God can meet, but this type of security is actually her mega need. The guy's mega need was honor and respect. Her mega need is this security. She needs to know that you put her and your marriage first, and that your commitment level to her is so high that the message she receives from you on a regular daily basis is that I'm yours first, and to my hurt, I'll take care of you first, even before me. And so what a great message that is for her, this security need. And listen to this. Every day, she needs to know the answer to one simple question. Here it is. Would you marry me all over again? That one simple question is answered by your words, by your actions, every day. And that's real security for her. And so that's a biggie. And so what is it, guys, that you do or say every day that at least gives that hint to her, you know what, he still loves me. You know what, I would marry you all over again.
You know, this is huge. This is really big for women. Studies show that the average woman thinks 11 negative thoughts about herself every day. Every day, your wife, on average, is thinking 11 negative thoughts about herself. Thoughts from fighting that extra baby weight that she just can't seem to lose, or discovering the menopause middle. Anybody else? Okay, guys, it's a thing. Just so know, when you get into the age bracket, it's a thing. To all kinds of other stuff. Your wife is probably dealing with a lot more self-condemnation than you realize. And for her to have that assurance from you on a regular basis that, you know what, honey, I love you. You are beautiful to me. You are the woman I married. You are the woman I'm committed to. You are the woman I'm going to spend my life with. Go so far in meeting that mega need of hers of security. She needs to know that you're glad you married her and that you would do it all over again.
In fact, okay, guys, it's your turn. I want you, husbands, take the hand of your wife, okay, and look her in the eye and say, I would marry you all over again. Go ahead. Okay, hey, you just met a big security need in her. Okay, let's go on to the next one. Her second need, second of these top needs of a woman, is a soft, non-sexual affection. Soft, non-sexual affection, number two. I'm not sure what he said, but it sounded funny. But oh, that's the single table. Okay.
I hope you guys are taking notes, okay? You take notes, okay?
Okay, so that's not I'd marry you all over again. I'd marry you.
No.
Okay, no, we don't have to go there.
Okay.
You
know what? Okay, this is a little aside. When we first walked in here tonight, it's decorated so beautifully. We were saying, you know what, we could have a wedding here after we're done. So if anybody's thinking, it's just no pressure, of course. But I'm only kidding.
Okay, this number two of the wife's greatest needs is soft, non-sexual affection. Some days, she's exhausted that everyone from the kids to coworkers and friends, they've wanted something from her all day. And that's when you need to remember this point. Here it is. There are times when she needs you to hold her, to rub her feet, give her a massage, and not expect anything in return. Okay, it's doable, guys. You can actually do this. Once in a while, you got to do this.
You can do it, I'm sure of it.
You need to let her know that you're just there for her, to hold her, to scratch her back. And try to resist the urge of your hand to go south. You know, you can do it. You can do it. And fix her a cup of tea. And you know, and she knows there's no strings attached. That kind of intimacy is like gold to her, and you need to give it to her.
And what a beautiful place for her to be. She is 100% confident that you are totally focused on her needs alone. And you know what? In that safe place of intimacy, she is far more open to take things to the next level. But, and this is important, that is totally her initiative in these moments. That's totally her initiative.
Okay, let's go on to number three, the woman's top needs. Open and honest communication.
You kind of struggle with this one, don't you?
This can be hard for us guys.
I know.
Just to, you know, to talk and to just let it go, talk about feelings and all, you know, sharing feelings definitely does not come easy for me. And in fact, here are a couple of guys that maybe you other guys can relate to. Ready? Watch this.
All right, I got it. She's gonna love it. Let's go.
Whoa, how'd you find a card so fast?
I am a speaker of lady language. I hear their voices in my head, much like Beethoven heard music.
No, I think those are just voices.
Either way, I've got a card, and you don't.
I'm trying to find one with the right words. I can't find one that really describes how I feel.
Here, this one.
This one. This is the one.
Yeah.
Okay. Sugar is sweet and so is honey. I bought you this card because I had no money.
That is so you.
Yes, it is. No, it's not. It's not me.
What are you trying to say?
I need a card that says, I don't deserve you. I never have, and I never will. From the moment that I first saw you, I knew that I wanted to be with you, to know you, to understand you. I am humbled that you chose me. I have married out of my league, and there's not a day that goes by that I don't recognize that fact. And I've never taken our vows lightly. What do I say to the mother of my children, my best friend, my soulmate? I love you can just sound so cliche and trite, but it's the only words that I know. I love you. I mean, that would be a card, you know? That would be a card that I'd want to buy. What's the matter? What happened?
Don't look at me!
Okay.
Well, look away!
I have... What's the matter?
It's like I'm a swimming pool, and your words are like cannonballs landing. Pull yourself together, man. Attention, everybody. We are in the presence of a true wordsmith.
No, we're not.
Allow his words to be the wings on which your cards fly.
No. No.
I want what he's having.
Okay, we need to go. We need to go right now.
I've got an idea. We'll get those cards that are blank on the inside, and we'll write your words on them, and then we'll give them to our ladies. But we have to write in calligraphy.
I'm just going to take your card.
Wait. What was that part about the true soulmates? I need a pen. I gotta write this down. That stuff is gold. That'll give me a whole Sunday of football.
So it is doable. You guys can do it. Dig down deep and those words will come out. You never know. Anyway, they had a lot of fun with that. But here's a wake-up call for us guys. You ready for this? Under open and honest communication. And this is a pretty straightforward wake-up call. Here it is. Meaningful communication has the same effect on a woman that sex has on a man. Now, let that sink in for a minute, eh? Some men think that I'm over-exaggerating the correlation here, but women know exactly what I'm talking about. As we've been studying marriage ministry, it seems seemed pretty extreme to me when I read this quote, and I asked Dan, is that really true?
And I said, absolutely. You know, she needs it in order to feel secure and satisfied in your relationship, to have that open and honest communication, heart-to-heart sharing. Am I right, ladies? Am I right? Am I on the right track here? Absolutely.
Well, when Ann and I were dating, we talked about anything and everything, but... After a few years of marriage, I kind of slipped into the more comfortable, yeah, the strong, silent type, and she'd want to talk, and I'd try to talk, and I'd try to draw blank, and I wouldn't really know what to say, and she would she'd kind of carry the conversation, and it would take me a while to just kind of drag things out of me, but eventually got a little bit better at it, and I realized it's not just a woman thing. A man needs to do this as well, and it's one of her greatest needs. And because I love her, I worked on meeting that need when I realized this was one of her needs. And I learned to contribute more than just 2 cents into the conversation. And it's taken a while, and I still have a ways to go, but I'm getting a little better.
You're doing better, honey. I think it's
thanks.
It's important that guys understand that it's not, as Ron said, talking to each other is not just a woman thing. It's actually one of her greatest needs, to have that open and honest communication with you. And so if you find it difficult to do, just start a little bit. Just start listening. Start to engage in one thing she says and draw out that concept instead of, because I know girls, our thoughts can be like spaghetti. They're all touching something else and we're on to another subject before we know it and we're talking about something way over here and he's still stuck back here thinking, but I thought we were talking about Saturday. And you say, oh no, we're talking about next June now. And so, but if he just lands on one thing and then ask her a question about it and then just start talking about that one thing, not the spaghetti, just the one thing, then you'll find that you're engaged in a nice conversation and she's feeling like you're really getting her, you're really there. And it's important to do. And something else that's important to pick up on is, as Ron said about the man's greatest need for honor, or I was saying for honor, If he doesn't find it at home, he'll go where he does find it. It's the same thing with communication, that if she doesn't have that communication need met at home, she's going to be drawn to that place where the open and honest communication is coming at her. And it could be from work or coworkers or friends or whatever. And you need to know that this is one of the most common seeds from which an affair can grow, when a woman doesn't feel emotionally connected to her husband. So it's really important that we take this seriously.
So we've talked about his needs and her needs and our differences, and we know from experience that our differences often lead to conflict in marriage. Conflict is something that we all deal with. We still have conflict from time to time, and we just need to...
We do not.
We do too.
We do not.
Anyway, and it is something that we all deal with, and there's a lot we could say on that topic. There's a whole kind of a seminar on dealing with conflict.
But we won't get into that.
We won't get into that. But it's vital as couples that we identify who the real enemy is, and it's not your spouse.
That's right.
Even in times of conflict, your real enemy is not your spouse. In fact, Jesus tells us who it is, and let's look at this scripture from John 10:10. The thief's purpose is to steal, kill, and destroy. Jesus said, my purpose is to give them a rich and a satisfying life. Mm-hmm. So there is a real enemy out there, and your marriage is under attack, whether you know it or not. Mm-hmm. There are spiritual battles going on, and we need to know our enemy. And the scripture, of course, would come to mind when you think about spiritual battles is Ephesians 6. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you will be able to stand firm against the strategies of the devil. He's got strategies and schemes to destroy your marriage. And notice that Ephesians 6 comes right after the other scripture we read earlier, Ephesians 5, talking about husbands and wives and some family relationships there. That this follows right on the heels of that, this idea of spiritual warfare. So I think Apostle Paul knew, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that there's a connection there. The enemy's out to steal, kill, and destroy your lives, yes, and your marriage. And we need to be on guard with the whole armor of God. And his top strategy, just like the Garden of Eden, Satan appeals to our selfishness and pride to drive wedges between you and God and between you and your spouse. And you know what the wedge looks like. If you've ever split wood, sometimes you just put that wedge in first, and then you drive that wedge into that log, and it's the farther it goes, the deeper it goes, eventually it's going to split apart. And so there's these kind of wedges, these schemes and strategy of the enemy. He tries to put wedges in there. And some of those wedges, we could talk a lot about them, but they would include like lies we believe from the enemy.
Lies like, there's no hope for us, or he or there, she will never change, or I married the wrong person, or you know what, guys, these are lies from the enemy, and don't believe them. Don't even entertain them. Don't even think them. They are lies from the enemy.
Other wedges include selfishness, secrets, anger, criticism, pornography, neglect, busyness, and just lack of priorities. Other things take priority, and you get too busy. These can be like wedges, and that just eventually will split you apart. And the list goes on. And you know the wedges that perhaps you're dealing with in your marriage, if you're here and you're married, and you know where the enemy can get a foothold in your life, and those can be driven down deeper and deeper until it comes to a very bad point. But there's also some good news.
Well, for us, when we were raising our children, we never argued much. But when we were raising the kids, because we came from totally different backgrounds, that was the wedge in our marriage. That was the arguing point for us, was how to discipline the children. I came from a military background. My dad was in the Army. My dad was a wonderful man, but he was extremely strict. And he's in heaven now and enjoying the blessing of the Lord now there. But when I was being raised, I was raised in an extremely strict home, and Ron was raised in a home that was loving and full of grace. And so when we were disciplining our children, we butted heads a lot, because I always thought, no, he should know better. He's got to have a, you know, he's got to be grounded for that. And Ron said, well, let's just give him another chance. And, you know, it was things like that where it was really, and we never did that in front of the children, argued, but it was a real wedge that was driving down in our marriage.
And it wasn't that I didn't receive discipline growing up, but that the different levels, I guess, and how harsh it would be. And so that's what it was over, the kind of the harshness of the punishment. And so we would have conflict over that, but we didn't want to allow the enemy to get a foothold in not resolving it right away. You know, the Bible talks about don't let the sun go down on your anger. That means you don't let it build, because as it builds, it just it's like the cork on a bottle that's you keep shoving stuff in there. You put the cork on, and it's just getting more pressure and pressure and pressure until it's going to explode.
It's gonna blow.
But you deal with it that day before you go to bed.
And so we had to learn how to compromise and work through all of that. And so thank the Lord we were able to do that.
So back to the screen here. The greatest way to push out the enemy's wedges in your marriage, and this is an important point.
This is very important.
Is to pray together. Pray together. Watch this. For couples who pray together regularly, the divorce rate is less than 0.001%. Isn't that amazing?
You remember at the beginning of when we first got up here, we were saying the divorce rate in Canada is 41%, but the divorce rate for couples who pray together is 0.001%.
And a three-stranded cord is not easily broken with the husband and wife and God. That's from Ecclesiastes.
Now, just in case you think we just pulled this number out of thin air, you might be interested to hear and surprised to hear where this statistic comes from. None other than Dr. Phil uses this statistic in his best-selling book, Relationship Rescue. And we'll put the quote on the screen of what Dr. Phil says about this. An interesting statistic shared by David McLaughlin in his wonderful series entitled The Role of the Man in the Family reflects that the divorce rate in America is at a minimum one out of two marriages, but the reported divorce rate among couples that pray together is about 1 in 10,000. He says, pretty impressive statistic. Even if you reduce it 1,000-fold, it's a fact. Praying together works. It's an almost guaranteed way to divorce-proof your marriage. End quote, Dr. Phil.
So if there's only one thing you take away from this evening, I pray that it's this. More than anything else, praying together will have the greatest positive impact on your marriage over anything else. Why is that? Because praying together as a couple is a powerful weapon against the enemy. It's hard to drive a wedge in when you're as one, and that one is like steel.
That's
together.
Right.
And both in a humble posture before God, acknowledging his sovereignty and desiring to do his will over yours. And that's the kind of unity that's hard to divide.
Besides that, it's really hard to stay mad at someone that you're praying with and praying for. You know, you just can't stay mad at them when you're praying together.
All right, so as we wrap up here, the bottom line, here's the heart of love in marriage. When your deepest needs are being met by God, and you're living out agape love in deliberately and sacrificially meeting the greatest needs of your spouse, and taking time to pray together, then Satan is powerless, and you have a 100% chance of success in marriage. Amen?
That's right.
Isn't that good? Praise God. Okay, well, let's just take a moment to pray. Thank you, Lord, for these truths from your word. Thank you that we just had an opportunity to get to know these folks and to share from our heart to theirs, Lord, but mainly from your heart. Lord, I pray that these truths will sink in and that there will just be a fresh sense of wanting to live out a marriage as you intend, Lord. Live out agape love in our marriages. And we thank you, Lord, that that is possible when we're surrendered to you, when we pray together, when we spend time together and communicating and just doing the things we know we should that are meeting each other's needs. And Lord, and when we realize also that there's an enemy out there that wants to steal, kill, and destroy our lives and our marriage, we thank you, Lord, that greater is he that is in us than he that's in the world, and that he is a defeated enemy. And so we claim total victory for every person here, every marriage here. And we thank you, Lord, that it's possible with you, all things are possible. We give you praise and we love you today. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. Well, it's been our privilege to share with you tonight, and I think there's still some yummy dessert coming.
Dessert's coming.
Anyway, God bless.